Well, praise God. We're so thankful. We're going to have service here in just a minute. We'll open up in prayer. And as there'll be, everybody's still settling in. There'll probably be some more to come rolling in around about 5 and 10 minutes after. That's just fine. We're just going to make room for everybody. And it's such a good thing to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. With one mind, one body, one vision, one Jesus. And bring us all together. Amen. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll play one more song, and then Chris and Justin are going to come up and lead us in praise and worship, and we're so thankful that you could attend today. For those that are new, my name is Pastor David Travis Fowler. So I'm minister of music. Chris King, his wife, Beth, Justin. He liked it so much last week. We treated him so good last week. He had to come back and get some more. So we're thankful that he's back. And I also want to say hey to my mom. My mom's here, Diane Smith. And all the new faces and the regular members too. We're just so thankful that we're here. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, dear Lord, we pray, dear Lord, that you would bring order to your home. This is your house, Lord. This is your place, Lord. These are your praises. These are your people. This is your gospel, dear Lord, your truth, dear Lord, which is able to save the souls, dear Lord. I pray that we would praise you in spirit and truth this morning, dear Lord, that we would receive this word, this bread of life, that we would eat the word, dear Lord, that the word would be inside of us, Lord. So when we depart from this place, we would have something to feed those, dear Lord, that don't have the word in their life. Jesus, I pray that we would stay on mission, dear Lord, and we would come here, dear Lord, to hear your word, dear Lord, which will set the captives free. We pray this in your holy, precious name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus steps down. I hear the spirit of a mighty trumpet.
That's an awesome song. Can you fathom that? Can you understand that? When Jesus steps out and calls us, his children home, oh, I get excited. Woo! Okay, I'm going to sing one. I tell you, the wonderful thing is, too, is that we can turn over all our problems, all our struggles, all everything, everything to Jesus, because he covered everything at the cross.
Amen.
When he said it is finished, everything was taken care of. It was all finished. It's just whether we turn it over to God or not, because he took care of our sorrows, our sicknesses, our anger, our feelings, any of the struggles we deal with, addictions, and any problems that we have with relationships or anything we deal with, he took care of it at the cross. And that is just so awesome. So this a lot of y'all know this song. But this song is just all about how we can just turn all of our struggles over to Jesus. So,
Amen.
I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone. In my distress, he kindly will help me. He ever loves and cares for his own. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me. Jesus alone. Tempted and tried, I need a great Savior. One who can help my burden to bear. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. He all my cares and sorrows will share. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me. Jesus alone. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Power, power, Yeah. Father God, we thank you for your spirit, God, and how it falls on this room. It falls on your people, God, your Holy Spirit, your very presence. Thank you so much for that. God, as we prepare to hear the word this morning, pray that you would fill Travis and overflow, God, that we would hear your voice through what he has to say this morning, through your word, Jesus. God, that you would empower him in this moment, Lord, to preach the gospel, God, to show your heart and to show your very presence on this earth, your very voice, Lord, that when you say, let there be light, there is light, God. When you say, let there be is. You call things that aren't as though they are.
Yes.
And you have that power, God. And you have that power in this room.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You have that power in our lives, God. And we surrender that to you. Lord, thank you for what you're doing in my heart. Thank you for what you're doing in the hearts here, Lord. And even in our physical bodies, God, the things that you're doing. Thank you, Lord, for your grace, for your love, for the cross. That you went to the cross despising the shame.
Mm-hmm.
But that you did it for the joy set before you. And we thank you that you love us the way you do.
Mm-hmm.
That we give you no reason to, but that you love us.
Mm-hmm.
Just thank you, God.
Let
us hear your voice this morning.
Thank you, Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
The calls are giving the Lord a praise. Praise God to the Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Father, for every stride.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Every stripe, every blessing.
God's amazing grace. Amen.
Amen. Yes.
Sir. You know, I don't know how to really start this sermon off by telling you that I've been planning on and talking to Chris about preaching the sermon on the Bethesda by the man laying by the pool of water, and that was like 3 weeks ago, and I haven't been able to get there yet, but we're still following Jesus through his journey to Galilee, speaking to the woman at the well. She was a Samaritan, Jesus being a Jew. We walked through that and how she went and left, and she went and got the other Samaritan men and brought them back, and Jesus pulled his disciples out to the side and told them that the harvest is ready, now is the time. And Jesus said to them that I have sent you to reap that for which you have not labored. Others have labored and you have entered into their labors. Meaning that sometimes we're going to get to reap what we didn't sow in a good way. And so that those who sow and those who reap may rejoice together. See, in the presence of God is joy. As I read on, as I was wanting to head on back to the man laying by the pool in Bethesda, that no one would put him inside the water. We'll probably get there next week. But there was a little lesson here I saw where Jesus was leaving. He was leaving Judea where the Samaritans were, and he was heading into Galilee. And we're going to be in John chapter 4, verses 43 through 54. I got a correction there. It was Judea that he was in with the Samaritans and the woman by the well. And he was welcome in Judea, but he wasn't welcome in Galilee of Cana, because people knew him as Jesus, Mary's son, Joseph's son. And we're going to be reading, like I said, if you want to follow along, it's in John chapter 4, verses 43 through 54. And it says this in God's word. Let this speak to your hearts. We should never be the same after reading God's word. It says, now after the 2 days, he departed from Judea, from the Samaritans, because he spent 2 days there with them. And from there he went into Galilee. For Jesus himself testified that a prophet has no honor in his own country. So when he came to Galilee, the Galileans received him, having seen all the things that he did in Jerusalem at the feast, for they also had gone to the feast. Verse 46. So Jesus came again to Cana of Galilee, where he had made the water wine. And there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus had come out of Judea into Galilee, he went to Jesus. He went to Jesus and he implored him to come down and heal his son, for his son was at the point of death. Verse 48. Then Jesus said to him, "Unless you people see signs and wonders, you will by no means believe." The nobleman said to him, "Sir, come down before my child dies." And Jesus said to him, "Go your way, your son lives." So the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken to him, and he went his way. And as he was now going, the nobleman saw his servants met him as he was heading to see if his son was alive or not. And his servants told him, "Your son lives." Verse 52. Then he inquired of them the hour that his son got better. And they said to him, "Yesterday, at the seventh hour, the fever left him." So the father knew it was at that same hour in which Jesus said to him, "Your son lives." And he said to himself, he himself believed, and his whole house. This again is the second sign Jesus did when he had come out of Judea into Galilee. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, dear Lord, for the reading of your word. We thank you, dear Lord, that it's living water. It's the bread of life, Lord. We have all that we need right here that's in front of us, Lord. We need not look for signs and wonders, Lord, when your word tells us truth, Heavenly Father. And we're saved by your truth and faith in it, dear Heavenly Father. I pray, dear Lord, that every heart, everybody, all the ones that are underneath the sound of my voice, dear Lord, would exercise their right to faith, to take your word for what it is and believe what the Bible says is so. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. As we read and follow the journey of Jesus, I wanted to name this sermon. I usually don't name my sermons anything. I don't title them, but I like the sermon. I want to call it Revisiting for the One. Jesus returning to Galilee, Cana of Galilee, revisiting for the one nobleman. See, soul winning, like we talked about of the week, transcends race and rank, but it also transcends regions. And as we follow our Savior's footsteps, we see him leaving a place where he was very welcome to go to a place where he was unwelcome. He leaves the Samaritans in Judea and travels back to his hometown in Galilee, Cana, to be exact, the place where he performed his first miracle at the wedding, turning water into wine. Now, I said that he wasn't welcome in Galilee, and I'm not all that wrong, because Jesus testified in verses 44 that himself testified that a prophet has no honor in his own country. See, there was some folk down in Galilee that knew Jesus as Joseph and Mary's boy. You see, Jesus the carpenter, we know Mary's boy, you know Jesus, yeah. Jesus down the block. See, they were very familiar with Jesus. And familiarity breeds contempt. Not like going to your neighbor's home too much and wearing out your welcome, but familiar in a sense, but familiar in a sense that they thought they had Jesus pegged. These Galileans thought they knew who Jesus was. And so they didn't respect him. And they didn't honor him. They did not receive his word. It says, see, we live in a world full of people who think that we got other people pegged. We live in a world full of people that would already think they know who you are. And we live in a world full of people that they think they know who Jesus is. And if they don't see Jesus as being God, then they don't know Jesus. Because the God of this Bible is Jesus Christ. Of course, our God is a triune God. I get asked a lot of times, yeah, Jesus is God's son, but he's not God. He's God's son. My friends, let's not get it confused. Let's not get it confused. Jesus Christ is God. Did I hear amen over there? Well, thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. See, we seem to forget. See, Jesus Christ was God in the flesh. See, Jesus has been here since the beginning of time. And Jesus was on mission, even going back to a place that he wasn't welcome, and going back to a place where people were very familiar with who he was. A lot of us wouldn't go back to those places, would you? If you wasn't welcome, you wouldn't go there. If it made you feel like they had no respect or no honor for you, you wouldn't want to return there, would you?
No.
If they didn't receive you, you wouldn't go there, would you? But see, Jesus went back for the one. He revisited a place where they were very familiar to him. See, they would probably even... We also live in a world full of times. I don't know if you know this or not, but everybody's writing reviews about people and about businesses. And reviews can hurt the person, but it also can hurt other people if they read the review. Everybody wants to write a review about somebody or about a book. There's a lot of people like to write a review about the Bible. They would like to give you a review because they think they know who you are. See, if they had to write a review about Jesus, it would have said something like this. Jesus, Mary and Joseph's boy. Crazy zealot. Long hair, sandal wearing. Says he's the son of God. He's very extreme, kind of the religious type. He's kind of churchy. Yeah, that's what they would have said. That's what they would have said, but they would have wanted, though, these Galileans, though, of Canaan, they wanted those signs and wonders. See, we want the heaven of the Bible. But see, you don't get the heaven of the Bible unless you choose the God of the Bible, Jesus Christ. See, speaking of reviews, I met an old fellow the other day. He was about 90-something years old. I'd say that's pretty old or getting up there. But he's right at 90 years old. And he was reading a book. And as I walked up to him, I said, "What are you reading?" And he told me something about some kind of classic American novel or something like that. He named a name. I didn't know it. And he began to tell me that he reads hundreds of books. He actually writes reviews of books. And he's written over 500 reviews. This man was real smart. You can tell he's very intellectual. I can only hope to be that smart. But I asked him, had he read the Bible? And then he looked at me and said, "No, it's been a long time." I said, "Well, I would like to know what your review is of the Bible." You say you write all these reviews for people, and authors call you up, he told me. Authors call him and say, "Please write a review." They really look forward to this man's review. And I asked him, "Well, I would like for you to review the Bible." He said, "Well, have you read it?" I said, "Yeah, I've read it 4 times when I was in the penitentiary. When they kicked that little Bible underneath my thing there." He said, "Well, do you remember it all?" I said, "No, but see, that's a good thing about God's Word, that you keep on getting to go back to that well. And you keep drawing back from God's water. See, it never doesn't stop filling me up. It just keeps filling me up. And if I'm empty, it's because I haven't visited the well that has living water." I'm talking about the Word of God. Yeah. And he looked at me kind of funny and laughed when I said penitentiary. And I just stared at him. And, it was almost like he didn't find any value in the Bible. It's almost like he was so familiar with it that he knew exactly what it said. It was even worth the review. It's like he knew exactly what it said. He was so familiar with the Bible, but maybe because it's so readily available that we keep it at arm's distance, but we don't open it and read it and review it. The problem is that our Bibles are closed, and closed Bibles don't make disciples. Closed Bibles don't bring revival. Yeah. But I visit people that say, "Yeah, I have a Bible. I have one right here." I go and visit people that have issues and real problems. Real problems that have real solutions that can be found inside the cover. Whether it be marital problems, problems of anxiety, problems of self-condemnation. You can find your solution. This is the fix. It's the Word of God. Can y'all hear me back there in the back? I'm going to get louder until it gets better. See, it was almost like he didn't find any value inside the cover of this book. I'm telling you, God is calling us all, and we're all responsible for reading the Word. Receiving the Word and eating the Word, and not just getting in the Word, but letting the Word get inside of you. God would like to know what your review is. What is your review? What is your review of the Bible? From what I've read, it tells me that Jesus Christ is God. Amen. And from what I read, it says that the blood of Jesus is enough to wash away any sin. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what kind of trouble you may think that you're in. God not only can get you out of trouble, but my friend, he can get you out of hell. Because if you haven't trusted in the blood, that's where you're going. Yeah, we have to bathe in the blood and get in the grace and get over ourselves. When we come to God, we have to come empty so he can fill us up. Amen. Boy, this is going better than I thought. You know, but I said that the Galileans didn't really respect him. But see, there were some Galileans that received him. And I'm going to read it right here in verse 45. It says, so when he came to Galilee, the Galileans received him, having seen all the things that he did in Jerusalem at the feast. For they also had gone to the feast. So they saw the water turn into wine. They received him because of what he had done. They were looking for something else from the Lord. Not as if he was enough, but they welcomed him for his signs and wonders. They believed with their eyes and not with their heart. See, we all know what Jesus said to Thomas. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen but yet still believe. John 20:29. See, these Galileans needed a sign to believe in Jesus. And Jesus was very aware of this. And I know this because this certain nobleman in verses 47 asked him to come and to heal his son. Come down and heal my son, for he is at the point of death. And some of us, my friends, I don't have this written down, but I'm going to say it. Some of us wait to the very last time, to you get to the edge of life before you start calling on Jesus. Some of us wait till we're at the point of death. See, God's good enough to start serving him. Give him the rest of your life. Give him the best of your life. We too want to give God our scraps, and we want the signs and wonders, and we want the healings, but we don't want the healer. See, they believe with their eyes and not with their hearts. But see, blessed are those who have not seen but yet believe. See, they needed a sign to believe Jesus. And Jesus was aware of this because the nobleman said, please come and heal my son, sort of like you made that water into wine. I need one of those wonders. I need one of those healings. And Jesus replied in verse 48, unless you people see signs and wonders, you will by no means believe. The nobleman said to him, sir, come down before my child dies. And Jesus said to him, go your way. Your son lives.
Oh, yes.
So the man believed.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
Go your way. Your son lives. Uh-huh. See, the word says, so the man believed. Mm-hmm. After Jesus said, go your way. The word said, so the man believed. The spoken word of God.
Yes.
See, the nobleman didn't believe that Jesus might, or that God might or God will, but he believed that God has healed his son. My beloved, our God is more than able. Our God has done exceedingly abundantly above all we've ever asked or think, according to the power that works within us. To him be the glory now and forever. See, it's the blood that's working in you. It's the power of God's saving faith. I'm talking about believing without seeing. Believing in the healer and not the healing. See, the man believed the word that Jesus spoke. And this is God's spoken word right here. Do you believe it? See, don't forget about the Samaritans back in Judea. Remember what they said after Jesus spent 2 days with them? It says it right here. This is scripture. It says, for we ourselves have heard him, and we know. They didn't say we think he might. They said we know that this indeed is the Christ, the Savior of the world. See, it's the Word. Somebody say it's the Word. We all awake. Amen. See, man is not to be lived by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God.
Yes.
See, Jesus is God. And he spoke the word, your son is alive. And so he believed. See, he knew. just like these Samaritans over there that said, we ourselves have heard him. For we ourselves have heard him, and we know that Jesus the Christ is the Savior of the world. Sounds like God to me. See, Jesus Christ is the Word of God. And without the Word of God, there will be no signs and there will be no wonders. You'll just be wondering where your sign is. It says in verses 51, we pick up, and Jesus spoke to him and that man went his way. He said, go your way, your son lives. He did what the Lord said. It says he went his way and he believed. He took his word for what it was and he did what he said. See, God will give you a word and then he'll give you a command. Mm-mm-mm. And he went his way. And he was going down and his servants met him and told him, saying, your son lives. Mm-mm-mm. Then he inquired of them the hour when he got better. He said, when did he get better? And they said to him, yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him. So then the nobleman knew that it was the same hour that Jesus said to him, your son lives, and he himself believed and his whole household. See, when you believe without seeing, like this nobleman, your blessing will be on its way. See, when you believe without seeing, when you believe God for his word and you do what he says, your blessing will meet you on your way. It will. Scripture did it for this nobleman right here. See, he was trying to back up God's word by talking to his servant, saying, well, when was he healed? And when we try to back up God's word, it always checks out.
Yes.
See, my brothers and sisters, the nobleman didn't need anything other than God's word. And if we seek more than what we need, we will never be happy with what we have. You want me to say that again? See, the healing is in God's word. The blessing is in God's word. It's the cure, it's the fix, it's the forgiveness. And his presence is in the word. You want God's presence over your house? You want God's presence over your children? You want God's presence over your little room down the hall? It's in his word. It's when we get in his word. It's his word. It's nothing else. It's not his word, and you go make sure you make all these meetings and go door to door or anything like that. It's just in his word. The presence is in his word. See, we must learn to be content with what we have. And he goes, what we have is the breath of God. We have a Holy Ghost inspired word. It's quick. It's powerful. It's sharper than two-edged sword, than any two-edged sword. Piercing even and dividing the soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow. And is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. God's word is alive, and so was this nobleman's son. He says it in 53, verse 53. For the father knew that it was the same hour. The nobleman knew it was the same hour in which Jesus said to him, your son lives. And the nobleman believed and his whole house. See, Jesus knew what he was doing, returning back to a place that gave him no respect, that gave him no honor. He was on mission. He was on mission. He stayed on mission everywhere he traveled. My brothers and sisters, the Great Commission may take you to some places where you are just tolerated and not celebrated. See, we shouldn't just go and make disciples only in places that we feel comfortable. See, some might say, though, well, what about that verse where it says that they don't receive you or honor you, you know, shake off the dust off your feet. What about that verse? Well, that's verses Matthew 10:4. Well, sometimes, my brothers and sisters, my beloved, that our sinful nature, the sinfulness of prayerlessness and pride will give you an offended spirit, and we will make us too quick to shake off the dust. Oh, you won't receive me, or I'm going to shake off the dust off my feet. See, we use that verse in a way that'll make us comfortable where we go. See, when we are on mission, sometimes God will send you behind enemy lines to revisit for the one. To revisit for the one. So, because you have all what you need. You have the sword of the Spirit. He said, well, God wouldn't send me anywhere I wouldn't feel comfortable. God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to die for you and I. They put him on a very uncomfortable cross. A very uncomfortable crown was swished down on top of his head. My, my. Is this speaking to anybody this morning?
Yes,
sir. Yes. See, sometimes God will send you. See, God looked across heaven and saw the most precious thing that he could find and sent him to a world where he was rejected and alone. Where they pierced his side. He was sinless. He was sin free. He paid the debt for you and me. He wasn't comfortable being here. And if we're comfortable around sinners, it might be because we are one. See, God may send you behind enemy lines for the one. Because if you give the word to the one, you have possibility of winning the household.